In the 19th century, the century of the machine, Western technology and ideology threatened to take over the world. Steam extends the reach of human power, hurrying millions over continents and across oceans. Charles Darwin's theory of evolution challenges religious beliefs. Backed by industrial power, white invaders overrun America and conquer the Plains Indians. Trade in opium leads to war in China, changing the world balance of power. Factories and machines change landscapes and lives the world over. 1,000 years of history. Millennium. Until the 19th century, power meant muscle, the wheel, wind, and water. Then, in Britain, a new force was prized from nature. The power of steam.
We may justly look upon the steam engine as the noblest machine ever invented by man. Pride of the machinist, the admiration of the philosopher.
Engineers and inventors became heroes. The buildings housing the machinery were like temples to the new age. The early engines, some the size of a three-story house, were used to pump surplus water from mines and drinking water from rivers. Every steam engineer's ambition was to achieve locomotion. The first to succeed was Richard Trevithick. In 1804, he won a bet that his machine could carry 10 tons of iron along 9 miles of a Welsh tramway. A local paper reported,
"Mr. Trevithick's new invented steam engine was found to perform to admiration. It is not doubted the machine will be made use of in 1,000 instances not yet thought of."
The prophecy came true, but not yet for Trevithick. His engines were simply too heavy for the rails. At first, steam-powered transport worked best on water. In 1807, in the United States, the first commercial steamer was launched. The Clermont took 32 hours to ferry passengers 150 miles downriver from Albany to New York. Just 12 years later, paddle steamers were crossing the Atlantic Ocean. In Britain, Trevithick's invention was gradually perfected. In 1829, George Stephenson's rocket reached a speed of 35 miles an hour. A young girl described the journey.
How strange it was to journey without any visible means of progress, bar the magical machine with its flying white breath and rhythmical, unvarying pace. When I closed my eyes, the sensation of flying was delightful.
The romance of steam inspired art. J.M.W. Turner painted rain, steam, and speed. The music of Felix Mendelssohn evoked the steamship journeys he took in Scotland. One of the first writers to describe the Atlantic crossing was Charles Dickens.
We stared apprehensively into a long, narrow apartment, not unlike a giant hearse, over which a rack, fixed to the low roof and stuck full of drinking glasses, hinted dismally at rolling seas and heavy weather.
Soon, it became possible to communicate even under the sea, using another new force of nature, electricity. Instant messages could be sent over long distances along cables laid under the Atlantic by the first iron steamship. The ship's designer was a celebrity, the British people's hero engineer, Isambard Kingdom Brunel. Brunel's imagination overcame nature, bridging rivers and tunneling through hillsides. But his victories cost blood. 100 workers died digging 2 miles of tunnel between Bristol and London. By 1850, railways and steamship routes encircled the earth. Ships no longer depended on winds and ocean currents. The migration of peoples on a massive scale was now possible. Continents could be crossed in days rather than weeks. Travel made it essential to synchronize the world's clocks. The Greenwich Observatory in London was formally adopted as the zero meridian, the center of world time, and the rest of the world divided into 24 time zones. All this made possible the tourist timetables, compiled by the world's first travel agent.
When making plans to make up a trip by railway, caravan or ship, what name is foremost on the lip? Thomas Cook and Son.
An itinerant preacher, Thomas Cook started his business in 1841. Inspired by the new railways, he organized his first day return trip, a temperance affair involving a picnic, a brass band, and a sermon against the evils of drink. Within a few decades, he was selling 3 million tickets a year to destinations all around the world, creating one of the first multinational companies. Cook took workers to the seaside, middle-class holidaymakers to Europe, and the rich to every corner of the British Empire and the world. Joseph Haydn published his oratorio, The Creation. It tells the biblical story of Genesis. God made the world in 6 days and crowned his creation with man. In the 19th century, this popular belief was challenged by a radical secular idea. It was developed here in an English village, in the course of a quest for a new understanding of nature. Scientists already knew the world was very old. They believed that animals had evolved from primitive forms. What they did not know was how. Charles Darwin was the first to solve the problem with his theory of evolution. His ideas arose when he was an amateur young scientist on board a round-the-world survey for the Royal Navy. In the Pacific, Darwin explored the Galapagos Islands.
I never dreamed that islands would be so differently tenanted. Temples filled with the varied production of God and nature. These species in the natural economy of the archipelago filled me with wonder.
Here, Darwin began to realize that species changed by adapting to local conditions.
We seem near to answering that mystery of mysteries, the first appearance of new beings on Earth.
But it wasn't just animals that adapted to their environment. At Tierra del Fuego, the very tip of the southern hemisphere, Darwin encountered the people living almost naked in this harsh environment.
Man, in his natural state, was so beastly, so vile, a foul, naked, snuffling thing.
Here he began to see humans for what they are, well-adapted apes. Darwin returned from his voyage with collections of specimens that gained him respect among professional scientists. back home, he continued to gather evidence of how life had evolved and analyzed it. But the tranquility of his life in the country masked an emotional turmoil. Darwin had married his cousin. Some of his children were sick, struggling to survive. When one daughter died, Darwin was devastated.
It was impossible for me ever to feel joy again. I was no longer sure of God's existence.
It made him see his own family as casualties of nature. Everywhere he looked, he saw that what drove the evolution of species was the struggle for survival.
Nature is savage, and the struggle must be won by the strongest.
His theory was further developed when he joined his local pigeon club. Here, fanciers selected individual birds and bred from them to enhance their speed, size, or beauty. Darwin saw that nature itself acted as the supreme selector.
These facts have thoroughly convinced me that species have been modified during a long course of descent.
Darwin observed that what was true of pigeons must be true of higher animals.
Man, wonderful man, is not a deity. He possesses some of the same instincts and feelings as animals.
Did man evolve like other animals? Or did intervention by God make him special? For 20 years, Darwin suppressed his theory. Racked with anxiety, he feared disgrace from religious critics and professional rivals. He was finally forced to publish when he learned that another naturalist had come to the same conclusions. On the Origin of Species was published in 1859. It sold out on the first day. The book horrified the religious establishment. Man's sense of goodness and beauty were not God-given, simply characteristics that had evolved. Darwin was lampooned. But some took up Darwin's ideas and applied them to human societies. If aggression was natural, so was war.
The civilized races of man will almost completely replace the savage races throughout the world.
Darwin's theory was hijacked by imperialists to substantiate a political program. The belief that the White West, with its superior machines, was destined to prevail and was justified in marching across the world to conquer. The West's firepower and mobility became unstoppable. Nowhere was the West's domination more clearly seen than in Africa. At the end of the century, Africa became the victim of a wholesale colonial takeover. Here, Europe's industrialized powers played out their own battle for the survival of the fittest. Images of the American West can be deceptive. Cowboy towns look ramshackle and rustic, but they were products of the industrial age. The West was finally opened up by mechanization and by the railroad. The first white settlers found the prairie too tough to tame.
A vast country, incapable of sustaining a dense population. An earth of iron.
Propaganda bathed the prairie in a religious glow. But at the outset, it was a space to be crossed, not occupied. The first colonizers found that this promised land was already home to other cultures. The plains sustained tribes of Native Americans who survived here with their herds of buffalo.
The buffalo was a gift from the Creator. It was given to the Native American to use to survive, to live on this earth. We use it, every part of the buffalo, from the horn to the hoof. Spirituality of the buffalo is very important to us. It meant everything to the Native American.
Here on the plains, the tribes set out to win empires. One people, the Sioux, had a vision of dominion over mountains, desert, and forest. On horseback, they ranged over the land and imagined it united. With guns bought from Europeans, they pursued their own territorial ambitions. But there was one rival they couldn't match. The invading white man. With their industrialized machines, this new enemy made war on indigenous cultures. The whites used belief in their manifest destiny to justify conquering the whole of the continent. Millions of immigrants came to America and crossed the country on newly built rail tracks laid by Irish and Chinese laborers. Faced with the loss of their land, the plains peoples were forced into guerrilla warfare. The Kansas Pacific Railroad employed the U.S. 7th Cavalry, commanded by General Custer, to defend the trains against attacks. The invaders were backed by the manufacture of guns and ammunition on an industrial scale. 2 million bullets a day were produced by the Winchester factory alone. The railroad also hired a young scout, William Cody, later known as Buffalo Bill, to kill buffalo to feed their workers. The fate of the plains people was directly linked with that of the buffalo. The tribes hunted to meet their own needs. A traditional method was to drive buffalo over a cliff. But for white settlers, the slaughter of buffalo became a sport and a way of undermining Indian economic survival. Following European settlement, the buffalo population fell from an estimated 60 million to less than 1,000. It was a startling demonstration of the power of industrializing societies. The plains' ecology was transformed, its people displaced. General William Sherman, in 1867, said,
"The more I see these engines, the more convinced I am that they all have to be killed or maintained as a species of pauper."
But resistance continued. A combined force of Sioux and Cheyenne annihilated the elite 7th Cavalry under General Custer at the Battle of Little Bighorn in 1876.
The Battle of the Little Bighorn was, at once, the greatest defeat ever suffered by the U.S. Army during the Indian Wars in the West, and the Native Americans' greatest victory in the long struggle to preserve their homeland and traditional way of life.
The victory provoked brutal reprisals.
Once we were happy in our own country, but the white man came and made little islands for us. And always these islands are becoming smaller.
While the surviving Indians were herded onto reservations, some were offered roles in a theatrical fantasy. In 1883, Buffalo Bill organized the first of his Wild West shows that toured the world for the next 30 years. Indian warriors traveled between performances on the very steamships and trains that had helped destroy their own culture. The participants, in a tragic history, replayed their experience as sanitized spectacle. Buffalo Bill had helped establish a Western myth of cowboys and Indians. Soon, a new motion picture industry would project these images to every corner of the globe. China began the 19th century still confident of her superiority over the rest of the world. Her population numbered 400 million. Her empire controlled the world's biggest economy. China enjoyed a favorable balance of trade with the West, receiving great quantities of money to pay for its silks, porcelain, and above all, tea. By 1800, the British consumed 10,000 tons of tea each year. So much money poured into China that a Chinese trader became the richest man in the world, Hao Kua, one of the few officially allowed to trade with foreigners. All foreign business was channeled through designated warehouses in what was then the world's largest city, Canton. But now, the age-old economic superiority of the East was under threat. Britain had found a product to reverse the balance of trade. Opium, grown on the hillsides of newly conquered India. The British invested massively in the manufacture and distribution of the drug, trading it for China's tea. Opium was already eating away at China's social fabric. That damage was made worse by Britain's commercial muscle.
Poison, alas, has been allowed to creep in unchecked, till at last barbarian smoke fills the market.
The British shipped opium to the Chinese coast and up its rivers, penetrating almost every artery of the country. The stability of Chinese society was threatened. In 1839, the emperor appointed Lin Zexu to stop the trade. Lin wrote to Queen Victoria.
Suppose there were people from another country who carried opium for sale to England and seduced your people into buying and smoking it. Certainly your honorable ruler would deeply hate it and be bitterly aroused.
Lin's appeal got nowhere. Instead, he tried to paralyze the trade. He took 350 British merchants into custody and ordered them to deposit more than 20,000 chests of opium near the Temple of the Three Buddhas. Thousands of balls of compressed opium were taken away, thrown into trenches, mixed with lime, and flushed into the Pearl River Delta. The British would respect nothing except force. The ensuing war led China to defeat and Britain to shame. In the British Parliament, William Gladstone criticized the government.
A war more unjust in its origin, a war more calculated to cover this country with permanent disgrace, I do not.
The man who helped negotiate the terms of China's capitulation was Hao Kua. He died a year later, a broken man in a shattered world. Held at gunpoint, the treaty negotiations were a one-sided game. Every Chinese move failed. China was forced to hand over 21 million ounces of silver. She had to pay for the war that Britain had started. 5 Chinese ports had to be given up to the foreigner. Britain gained Hong Kong. Other Western nations exploited China's war wounds. The industrial powers moved in to acquire trading concessions. After defeat, China was invaded by Western ways. On China's doorstep, foreign merchants lived in grand houses on boulevards, like those of Europe. 150 years later, these buildings have now been reclaimed. Hong Kong has been handed back to China. Lin Zexu is celebrated as a national hero. And the Opium War is replayed as a game. Britain in the 19th century, workers' lives were transformed. Weaving was no longer done at home, but in factories, on machines still operated by hand and foot. Now, work was controlled by a new invention, punch cards that automated production patterns repeated over and over again. Then came steam. Conditions were transformed by relentless noise and danger. Workers had become merely the extension of machines.
Whilst the engine runs, the people must work. Men, women, and children are yoked together with iron and steam to the machine, which knows no weariness.
Everywhere, extraordinary inventiveness contrasted with oppressive working conditions. Dust and fumes choked factories and poisoned workers.
They had children cleaning in here at 6 years old. They really should have been 10, but they got them in younger. Started at 5 o'clock in the morning till 10 o'clock at night. And if they were late, they got fined.
Across the Western world, factories transformed the landscape, smothering crowded cities with smoke and grime. Writers described the effect in Britain.
A half-frightful scene covered over with furnaces, rolling mills, steam engines, and sooty men. At night, the whole region burns like a volcano spitting fire.
The wretched dwellings of the poor are scattered haphazard around them. From this foul drain, the greatest stream of human industry flows over to fertilize the whole world. From this filthy sewer, pure gold flows.
From the exploitation of factory workers emerged a struggle for trades unions. These helped gain political representation and new rights for working men, women, and children. linchpin of industrialization was steel manufacture, now about to be transformed. Traditional methods of casting were replaced by the industrial magic of Henry Bessemer's new process.
Out came a volcanic eruption of such dazzling coruscations as had never been seen before. When combustion had expended all its fury, most wonderful of all, the result was steel.
With tough, cheap steel, nations could build railways and mass-produce guns. They could reach further and hit harder than ever before. Around the world, industrialization altered the balance of power. The first regions to industrialize dominated the rest. Heavy industry centralized power. In the American Civil War, the industrial northern states defeated the agricultural south. In Japan, the industrial south helped modernize the whole country. In 1875, a young Japanese businessman noted,
"We needed industry to attain the goal of becoming a rich nation."
Newly industrialized, Japan became the strongest power in the Orient. Around the world, the victims of industrialization, the workers, increasingly shared its benefits. A cycle of prosperity linked mass production, rising wages, and growing demand for manufactured goods. Washing machines and sewing machines changed people's lives. The camera arrived to record accelerating social change. Popular newspapers, advertising of mass-made products, the motor car, at the end of the century, still photographs began to move. In 1898, the Lumiere brothers, with their first motion picture camera, filmed the steam train arriving at a station. A fitting and moving image of a century in which the world had been transformed by the machine.